Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Colin. It's wonderful to see such support that Rohan has got this weekend. Putting a weekend together like this has been a dynamic effort on behalf of a lot of people, and I think it's great that Rohan supports the idea of introducing part of the Rohan family into an actual event to take part like this. And I'm going to show you a short introduction of images of some of the things that took me to the point when I decided that I can no longer keep this to myself. I have to communicate it. And so what I do is I shoot images of mountains and nature, and the premise on which I shoot is to discover how, not what it is, but how it feels. I try and shoot something that you can't actually see. But this is where I began. A lot of mountaineers and outdoor people begin their mountain lives on Ben Nevis. You may recognize the Tower Ridge here. My life on Ben Nevis didn't last long. In my early days, in the early 1970s, I became a victim. And that was a huge learning curve, to be a victim. And I eventually managed to get my way out of this terrible situation where we were climbing on the north side of Ben Nevis in the winter time. My companion fell 150 feet. I caught him on the rope. I then held him swinging below me for 17 hours. So I was learning. I was hypothermic, etc., and we had to be rescued. The rope was too insecure to make an exit. And so Mountain Rescue took part. They were all awarded the Royal Society, Humane Society Award for bravery. They all went to meet the Queen. I went home empty-handed. My friend was perfectly all right. It was just terribly dramatic and very inauspicious because I was a teacher at the time and ended up in the papers. But soon I was back on the mountains, actually a couple of months later, in the Coolins of Scotland. You probably all know the Coolin Mountains, the greatest mountain range in this country, in the British Isles. And of course, the traverse of the Coolins in winter is a very, very rare and extraordinary expedition. It took 3 days in the year of 1978. But who would believe that this is this country, in this British Isles, more like Alpine? But you know, in those years through the 70s, I was dreaming of going further afield, and I was reading a lot of historical stuff about explorers all over the world, and was particularly and especially taken with this dream of going to polar regions. And really the only way to go to polar regions in those days is to follow the greats and to create, hopefully, an expedition that had scientific purpose. So the first thing I did was to apply to the British Antarctic Survey. I had been teaching physical education for 10 years and thought, enough's enough, which was a very difficult decision because, believe me, I really enjoyed it. And I got a job with the survey, and we sailed south. Initially, I flew down to South America and then eventually in small aircraft across the Southern Ocean and across the Antarctic continent to an ice station. Now, in my state of mind, can you just imagine what it was like to enter a crystalline world? I'd seen a bit of snow in Britain, I'd been climbing in the European Alps, but suddenly I was seeing an amazing world. A world full of wonders beyond my dreams, and thought maybe I'll take some photographs and see what happens and see if I can do anything with them. And so my job down there was actually not as a photographer, but as a safety officer working with a single geologist. And we were to go sledging in the ice cap for 3 months, and this is 200 miles away from the ice station. You can see our sledges at the back. And they were carrying several tons of luggage and survival supplies that might last us for 3 months. And in actual fact, we got beleaguered in very, very serious weather, and we had 100 mile an hour winds, and the tent was buried. Now, these tents are designed to be buried because they have a little air hole here at the top, a rubber tube with a string through it to pull through to get rid of the snow from the middle. Inside the tent, it's quite sophisticated. A nylon inner, 3 layers of outer, and then inside, the tilly lamp to keep us warm. In those days, a lilo, do you remember lilos? Big airbed with a sheepskin on top, and then a carry mat on top. It was getting very sophisticated, and then some super sleeping bags on top of that. So we were cozy warm. We had a box full of pots and cooking utensils and a radio to communicate with the ice station. Now, in a big blow, two of you confined in a tent with nowhere to go but just listen to the silence. I had a novel. I had a really good Russian novel to read. My companion Brian didn't. And what he did in those 4 days was tantamount to bringing our relationship into near despair, because this is what Brian did. And luckily, I don't have any audio effects for this, but I can mimic the squelching and clicking and squeezing of this thing.